Today we are going to be learn the topic generation of impulse voltage. So this figure shows the standard impulse voltage waveform. So if you observe this waveform, so it is specified by three parameters, mainly the peak value, then the rise time, that is T1, and the time to decay to the half of the peak value on the wave tail from the zero value to the peak and from peak to the half of the peak value on the wave tail. So that will be T2. So a standard impulse voltage wave is always specified by these three parameters: peak value or maximum value, rise time, and time to decay to half of the peak value. So for example, 100 kV 1.2 by 50 microsecond. So 100 kV is the peak value, 1.2 microsecond is the rise time, and 50 microsecond is time to decay to the half of the peak value on the wave tail. So this is an example of a standard impulse voltage wave. So now we'll discuss what is here. So this rising portion of your impulse voltage wave, it is called as a wavefront, and the falling portion of this wave, it is called as a wave tail. So time required by this wave to reach to the peak value, that is denoted by rise time, and it is T1, and the time to decay from zero to peak and from peak to the half of the peak value on this wave tail. So that duration required or time required, it is denoted by T2. So this is called as time to decay to the half of the peak value. So your impulse voltage wave, it is a unidirectional wave. So it can be a positive impulse voltage wave or it can be a negative impulse voltage wave. So this type of impulse voltage wave is required to be generated in the laboratory for testing your high voltage insulators, because your high voltage insulators, they are outdoor equipments, and your outdoor equipment has to bear the condition of lightning stroke. So whenever a lightning stroke occurs, so in that case the nature of the voltage will be a impulsive nature. So it may be a positive impulse or it may be a negative impulse. So that impulse voltage has to be withstand by your insulating devices. So we need to test our insulating devices under that condition in the laboratory. For that purpose, we need a impulse voltage generators in the laboratory. So we'll discuss the circuits which are used to generate the impulse voltage wave in the laboratory. So this is a single stage impulse generator which is used to generate the impulse voltage in the laboratory. So figure shows the figure A and figure B shows the single stage impulse generator. So this is a single stage impulse generator which consists of a capacitor C which is acting as a source. So this capacitor C, it is acting as a source and it is charged with the help of a DC source. The capacitor CB is the capacitor across which we are getting a impulsive output, and that impulse output is utilized to test the insulating devices or insulators. Then a spark gap is there, then two resistances are there, RD and RE. So here the resistance RD, it is acting as a damping resistance, and it is also used as a charging resistance. So its value is 20 to 30% of your resistance RE. RE is called as a discharging resistance and having the high value. So its resistance value is high as compared to the resistance RD. So the basic difference between the two figures, that is figure A and figure B, is that the resistance RE is placed before and after the resistance RD. That is only the difference between the two circuits. Now we'll discuss how the circuit is going to be work. So initially the capacitor C, it is charged to its rating with the help of a DC source. So DC source will be connected and the capacitor C is going to be charged to its rating. So in this capacitor C is charged, then the spark gap which is over there, that is going to be triggered with the help of some external circuitry. We can trigger that spark gap, and once the spark gap is going to be triggered, then in that case the circuit is going to be closed over there. So due to which the potential across the capacitor C is applied to the circuit. So the capacitor CB will now start charging to its peak value within a short time. So during this, the potential across the capacitor C, it goes on decreasing, and once the capacitor CB is charged to its peak value, it will not charge higher than its rating. So it will not charge further over there. So this capacitor CB will now discharge through the discharge resistance, that is RE, and its value will decrease from peak value to the zero value. This discharge time is more than the charging time, and the nature of the voltage which we obtained across the capacitor CB will have the same nature as we have discussed regarding the impulse voltage wave. So this voltage can be utilized to test the test object such as a insulator or a insulating device which we need to test under the impulse case. Then the next circuit we'll discuss, that is a multi-stage impulse generator. So this multi-stage impulse generator circuit, it is also called as a Mach circuit. So in the previous case we have seen a single stage circuit. Now here we have multi-stage circuits with the help of which we can generate the impulse voltage which will be having a multiple magnitude. So if you see the circuit, so there are number of stages. So this is first stage, this is second stage, third stage and a fourth stage over there. So in each stage there are two resistances, R1 and R2, which are acting as a charging resistance. Then capacitor C1, C2, C3 and C4, they are connected in parallel with each other, and they are connected in parallel with the DC source. Then a spark gap G1, G2, G3 and G4 are connected over there in each stage, and finally the resistance R0 is connected and the capacitor CB is connected over there. So the test voltage is test object is connected across the capacitor CB to which we need to test under the impulse case. So we'll see the operation of this circuit. So initially a DC source is connected at the terminals A and G with the polarity shown in the figure. So with that, the capacitors C1, C2, C3 and C4, they will get charged to their maximum potential through the resistances R1 and R2. So initially all these capacitors will get charged to their maximum potential. Then with the help of an external triggering circuit, we are going to be trigger the gap G1. So when we are going to be trigger the gap G1, then in that case the point B is going to be connected with the point G, which is a negative polarity, which is at negative polarity. So negative polarity is going to be applied at point B. So this is a G point which is at negative. So when you trigger this gap, in that case a negative polarity will be applied to a point B over here. So due to this, the charge redistribution is going to be takes place at capacitor C1, and the potential at the capacitor changes to minus V0. So due to this, what will happen, the charge redistribution is going to be takes place here, and due to that the potential at this capacitor is changing to minus V0. So the potential at point C is due to the capacitor C2, and this potential is a plus V0 potential, and the potential at the point H because of capacitor C1 is minus V0. So in that case, the total potential which is applied to this G2 gap, it is 2 times the V0. So because of application of 2 times the applied voltage, the gap G2 is going to be triggered out automatically. So due to that, again this G1, C1, G2 and the C2 capacitors, they are going to be connected over there. So again, the charge redistribution is going to be takes place at capacitor C2, and due to that, a negative potential will be applied by the capacitor C2 from this side to the gap G3, and here the capacitor C3 is already charged to the plus V0 potential, so that will be applied by the capacitor C3 to this point of your gap G3, and in that case 3 times the applied voltage is applied to this gap G3, and due to that the third gap is also going to be triggered out. So again, this will get connected over there. Again, the charge redistribution will take place over here, and the negative potential will be applied to this point of gap G4, and the positive polarity will be applied by the capacitor C4 to this point of your gap G4. So due to that, 4 times the applied voltage is going to be applied here, and because of that, the gap G4 is going to be triggered out, and due to this, the complete circuit will be connected from G to B, then B to H, then B to C, H to C, and then C to I, then I to D, then D to J, and then J to E, and finally J to E, and finally E to K over there. So up to this point, the potential will be applied over there. So this potential is then applied to the capacitor CB, and due to this, the capacitor CB is going to be charged to the potential, that is 4 times minus 4 times V0 over there, and across this capacitor CB, we are going to be connect our test object to which we will need to test for the impulse voltage. So in that way, we are going to be generate the 4 times the applied voltage as an impulse voltage across the capacitor CB. As your capacitor CB is there, so the charging time will be less and the discharging time will be more over there. So in that case, the nature of the voltage which is obtained across the capacitor CB will have the impulsive nature. So in this way, we can generate the high impulse voltage in the laboratory with the help of a Mark circuit or a multi-stage impulse generator, and which can be useful in testing the high voltage insulators in the laboratory. So hope you have understood the topic. Thank you.